Here's the reality of it. You know, there are subjects and things that we talk about that, I'll be quite honest with you, I would rather not do. You know, how many people want your life, you know, and I'm going to say as well, you want every day to be a happy day, every day to be a jump up and down day, every day to be filled with joy, every day to be filled with just excitement and fun things to do. How many people would like days like that, like every single day? All right. Here's what I've learned in life. For that to happen, for you to have those kind of joy-filled days, there are times where we have to have serious conversations as well. There are times we have to set ground rules. We have to have understandings of different things so that even as a family, we can go out and have fun, right? You know, with my five kids, I would have to say, look, here's the rules. You can't run on ahead, right? Can't stay behind. You got to, you know, hold our hands, all of those things. Why? Because there were safety rules involved. Well, in a sense, what we're going to talk about is something that is not normally talked about in church. And a couple of months ago when we were developing this series, Out of the Darkness, we talked about this area, and I said right at the time, nope, don't want to do it. That's what I said. And so as we kicked it around and talked about it, they said, no, we need to do it. And I'm like, I don't want to do it. It's depressing, all right? And so they said, but we need to talk about it. And as we talked about it more, we realized that most churches don't talk about it. We realized that all of a sudden that sometimes in some churches we do the jump up and down stuff, we do all the fun stuff, but we neglect some of the important things that will help us have a joy-filled life. And so what I want to do is talk to you this morning about dealing with depression. Now, that doesn't sound very exciting, does it? But here's the thing. If you're a person that's sitting here, and statistically, 1 out of 9 of you have taken medication this month specifically for depression. That's a statistic. That's just in the church, outside the church. That's just what it is. In other words, there are people right here suffering directly from and actually getting treatment for it. That's not to mention undiagnosed depression that's going on, which is, you know, again, brings that percentage up. So the bottom line, this is something that affects us all. So 1 in 9 actually took medication in this last month. Then what about the rest of us who maybe aren't taking medication? Okay, we know someone who's dealing with it, maybe a family member. Maybe at times we are dealing with it as well. And I'm not talking about those kind of days where you just have a bad day. You know what I'm saying? Maybe somebody yelled at you at work or you know, your car broke down or you know, and you're like, oh, man, what a crummy day I've got. And you're just kind of bummed out for the day. I'm talking about something where you fall into a crack or a crevice or a hole that's so big you can't see the light of day above you. And you can't climb out of it no matter what you do. And, you know, and so the people in the world would refer to that as clinical depression. And it's very real. In fact, right this week, even though we've planned this months ago, this very week I got a call from a family here in the church whose grandson just attempted suicide 2 days ago. Now, he's okay. Thank God. Amen. It's all right. But depression taken to its extreme is the end of life. That's really where depression, that's where the enemy wants to take a person in the area of depression. Thank God that God has a better plan. And here's the thing, if you've fallen into that trap yourself, I want you to consider this. Do not perform a permanent solution to a temporary feeling. Let me say that again. Do not do a permanent solution, hence suicide, for a temporary feeling of depression. And no matter how deep that depression is, it is temporary. Feelings come and go. Now, it may not feel like it at that moment, but it is temporary, and God has a plan to help all of us through it, amen? Now, I wish that every time I prayed for someone that was dealing with depression, boom, it was gone. And sometimes that happens, and awesome to celebrate that. But there are times where it's like, okay, what now? And do you just abandon that person? Do you just say to the person, I guess God's just not working for you, I guess, sorry. You know, that's not the nature of God. But here's what the nature of God is, that often what you and I do is we put God in a box and we perceive he's going to do something a certain way. And yet we see in the Bible where it wasn't always instantaneous. We see that Jacob wrestled with God. We see that Paul wrestled with the Lord. We see even Jesus wrestling with the Lord in the Garden of Gethsemane. In other words, the answer wasn't always automatic and quick. Yet, I want to assure you that in this whole area of depression, that God is still there to help. He may not be working the way you and I think he is or should, but God is still at work. God is still King of Kings and Lord of Lords, amen? And if we allow him to be at the preeminence, even in dealing with depression, he will be there, amen? Statistically, the ages between 15 and 24, you know what the leading cause of death is? Suicide as a result of depression. It's horrible. 40,000 people in America last year perished by suicide. 40,000. 40,000 lives that Jesus loved and had a purpose for each and every one of them. And that's my heart as we discuss this subject, that we can come to a place of maybe having a greater understanding of it if we're dealing with it. Or if you're that friend or that you're that neighbor or that family member, that it can help you understand. In other words, this subject affects each and every one of us here. And so, though I don't want to talk about it, I do want to talk about it. You get what I'm saying? I'm like Paul, you know, my head says, no, I don't want to talk about it. But my heart says we need to talk about this. And at first service, we had some amazing miracles happen as a result of us bringing this forth. Because here's the thing, for Christians especially, there's this shame and guilt associated with mental illness. In that somehow it's in a category all by itself. Listen to me. Mental illness, what does that really mean? It means that your mind, something's wrong with it. So why is that any different than if you have an issue with your kidney or you need a valve changed in your heart? It's an organ in your body. Your brain is an organ in your body. And so why do we treat it differently? Or why is your stigmatism, in the church especially, that it's somehow different? It shouldn't be, amen? We should be here to help one another through the difficulties of depression when you're suffering from it. I don't want any person to ever feel any guilt or shame of coming forward and saying, look, I'm dealing with some really lows here. I need help. Will you come alongside of me? And no one here in leadership will ever mock you or ever say, well, you just need more faith. You just need to do this. Just unless God specifically directs you, of course, or directs us. But the point is, we will come alongside of you and say, I'm with you. I want to help you through this because there is an answer, and the answer is found in who? In Jesus, amen? So I'm going to introduce you to a couple of people who know firsthand depression, who know and have experienced it, and they're going to share their story, and they're really important people to me. They're people who have been part of this body for, I don't know, it must be 6, 7, 8 years. Yeah, 7 years. I'm seeing fingers held up. I can see them. Seven years. They've affected my life in a profound way. They've been a blessing to this church body. They truly are friends in a personal way as well as friends of Jesus. Amen. Put your hands together for Brian and Brenda Bovey. We'll make sure all the sound stuff works. Brian, are you on?
I'm on.
There you go.
Good morning.
Amen. Good morning. Amen. They're going to bring some chairs out so we can sit down. You know, this is a big deal, and for each and every one of you, when you think of your life, think of some of the most private things that you might have going on. Are you willing to just come and do this? Let me tell you something. That's a big deal for Jesus, and I believe God's going to bless them for what they're doing for us. Amen. I always feel like a little kid when I get myself up on these chairs. We used to have these other chairs. I liked them better. They're the ones that twist. But the problem is the staff looked at me, and I was playing on it the last time I interviewed somebody, and they said, you look like a little kid playing on a chair. I'm like, yeah, I like it. So they gave me this now, so I can't swing anymore. Amen. Well, guys, I am so glad that you're here with us to be able to share with us. And, you know, we essentially have the two sides of this. And, again, each one of us connect to this. We have one who has dealt with depression, and then we have the one closest in being able to help. And all of us fit into the category one way or the other. And maybe we've even exchanged roles from time to time. But either way, I believe that this is going to be encouraging to us. So I didn't do this at the first service, but can I pray? Is that okay? Father, we're just grateful for Brian and Brenda to be here, to be able to open up their hearts to us and just be open about this whole area of depression, that we might have just a little deeper understanding. And in understanding, be able to help those around us and maybe be able to be free from some of the guilt and shame connected to depression. So, Lord, be with us as we discuss this subject in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, Brenda, can you take a couple minutes and maybe take us back as to how this kind of all started and to where you are today?
Yes. So throughout my life, I have experienced very severe clinical depression in three episodes, I'll call them, of my life. And the very first time that I had to face it was when I attempted to go away to college after graduating from high school. And I just was overwhelmed by it. It was just too much for me. I just couldn't handle it. And I And, you know, I think that that might be a common thing, and people kept calling it the freshman blues, and that it would get better and all that. I went to seek counsel there, and but unfortunately, it got the best of me, and I ended up having a nervous breakdown, and I had to come home. And unfortunately, it didn't go away. You know, it would have been nice if I just came home, and it's like, okay, well, I'm home now. Let's figure something else out, or maybe I can go to school locally or whatever. But it was too far gone at that point, and so I was in a really bad place. And but through through time and treatment, I was healed. I was cured. And then it was actually after that experience, I ended up going to Dutchess Community College, and that's where I met Brian. So when I look back at that time in my life, I'm very thankful for, you know, how God works through even.
Yes.
Things that weren't supposed to happen, or you know, negative things in our lives, he still
works it for
good. He works for the good, yes, in all things. So I'm not, by no means am I saying that depression was God's will, because I know it's not. And then I went through it again, and the second time happened to be after my daughter Rachel was born. I did have a crisis pregnancy situation with her, and a couple months after being home with her, it happened. It just came upon me, and yes, it was the craziest thing. And and again, it was actually more severe than the first time. But and I was a born-again believer at that point, and I did have a very supportive church, very supportive family. Of course, that was Brian's first experience with it. He knew I had experienced it before, still married me, which I'm very thankful for. But at first, he was baffled by it and frustrated and angry, as anybody would be. But what he chose to do was to research depression. And so by doing that, he became very sympathetic and compassionate, sure, to me, and he actually was very encouraging to me. And again, a treatment did bring me out of it. And then I weaned off that treatment, and I was fine for, I think, 17 years or whatever. And then actually, unfortunately, just a couple years ago, I went through it again. And so this was the third time, and again, it was actually even more severe, if you can even believe that, because I couldn't imagine it being any more severe, right, than it was. And of course, here I was at Reach Out, you know, in a spirit-filled, you know, yeah. I really didn't think it would ever happen to me, yes, again. And unfortunately, it did. But this time, like I said, it was more severe, and the typical treatments were not helping me. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, I believe it made me worse. I believe it actually worsened my condition, yeah, severely. And what ended up happening was, a sister in Christ in our church. This is just an interesting thing that happened. I ended up having ECT treatments, which for me was the answer. It actually worked for me. But prior to that, Robin Stanziola actually had a vision. She had told my mom that she actually had a vision of my brain, and like I guess it was like electric.
I was there. I heard.
The exact details, yeah, but and that was before the decision was, yeah, even made. So I'm just giving that. That's just an example of how God was confirming and, yes, working through. For whatever reason, that's what I needed to kind of just reboot, yes, or whatever. And so that brought me out of it. And the doctor would have wanted me to stay on that treatment for the rest of my life, especially knowing my history, and I wasn't going to do that, sure, because it was actually creating more anxiety, and I knew that that wasn't for me. I knew, yes, I know that God defies all of this, yes, you know, and so I didn't have to have my life be defined by that, yeah, and so I sought out natural ways to battle this and to deal with it, and that's kind of what I've been doing, and I've been off the treatment for a long, sure, time now. So.
Now, Brian, you're the one closest, nearest and dearest to Brenda. You know, what were your emotions and feelings of this whole event as it transpired? Because she probably shared with you what had happened, you know, when she went to school, but you probably had no idea the depth of this.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, when someone says, oh, I'm in depression, you're like, oh, yeah, you step off, it's no big deal. But when it hits that hard, so close to home, It scared the living daylights out of me. Mm-hmm. I have never had so much fear, you know, that came over me. Fear, you know, I was bewildered, you know, I was beside myself, not knowing what to do. You know, if you guys know that me as a builder, I work with my hands, so I fix everything. Mm-hmm. I can fix anything. But this was something that I could not fix. You know, it, you can have all the right words to say. You could have all the perfect Bible scriptures. And I could talk to him, I'm blue in the face. But none of that would penetrate through the darkest part. She could not receive anything that I'm saying. And so this was something where, for me, I had to give it over to God. This is something where I just literally fall to my knees and say, Lord, you know, this is something that it's you got to do this. You know, you've called me to protect her, to help her. Show me what you want me to do, what to say, where to go. And it was really the Lord is the one that really I felt was key and instrumental in guiding and giving me words of wisdom and insight on what to do and where to go and how to be.
That's good. You know, one of the issues that fixers, I'm a fixer too, is by nature, and I'm sure some of you are fixers as well, we're looking for the source. You know, why did this depression happen? You know, what was the trigger? And there are times where there are trigger points where these things happen, but sometimes there's not. And, you know, there's no rhyme or reason. It just begins to happen. And Jesus addressed this a little bit. You know, and there's a scripture I brought up at the first service, and I think it's worth bringing up again in John chapter 9. The disciples are looking and at this man who was born blind. And here's what it says in scripture, John 9 verses 1 and 2. Now, as Jesus passed by, he saw a man who was blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, saying, Rabbi or teacher, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? So immediately, because there was a problem, the disciples made this connection that sin was directly involved. That in other words, somebody's done something wrong. It was either the parents, it was either the man himself. And I love how Jesus responds to this, and I believe it speaks to the situation here today. Jesus answered, neither this man nor his parents sinned, but that the works of God should be revealed in him. Now, you could interpret this a couple different ways. You could say, oh, well, then God put this on this guy so that God could heal him. Just so you know, that's crazy talk, okay? Just so you know. Don't think that way, all right? It's just that because of sin nature, because of the world that we live in, the fallen world that we live in, there's sickness here. And as a result of it, Jesus has come to do what? Fix it. You know, not make it, but fix it. And so as I look at depression, as I look at mental illnesses, as I look at any ailments of any sort, that's the heart of God. Not so much for us to pinpoint things, although sin can be an issue. If it is, we need to repent, of course. There's other things that could be an issue, and we're going to talk about those things in a few minutes. But regardless of that, to say, Lord, here I am right now. This is what's going on. Help. And it sounds like that's where you got to. You just couldn't make it happen, but come to that place of just trusting Jesus to do something. All right, I want to change gears for a minute. Help us. You know, I've dealt with a little bit of depression, but it's nothing compared to what you're talking about. Help us to understand what's going on in your mind, if you can, so that someone here can say, okay, I sort of understand. I don't get it maybe, but I sort of understand. Yeah. Help us with that.
So what I'm describing is when you're in full-blown depression, okay, because I'm not talking about just having feeling down or feeling not right, or because I deal with that anyway. Yeah. I mean, you know, that is part of life, and you can't be happy and wonderful all the time. And I mean, that's my goal, but it's hard because things happen. So, but I'm talking about when I'm in that place. It's a very dark place. You feel hopeless. Yeah. You feel worthless, and you feel as though you're better off dead, basically. That there's no point in living, it'll be better. You're actually convinced of that, which, as I'm saying that, it doesn't make sense to me, even now, and I've been through it. So it's almost like, you know, you're possessed, basically, or like a cloud. Something there's a great deception, let's put it that way. You're deceived, and you actually forget what it felt like to feel fine, to not feel that way. It's a crazy thing, but you can't. And people will try to remind you and say, "But don't you remember, Brenda? Look at all these things." And it just nothing. It's like it just bounces off, you know. And it's really a horrible, horrible, dark, miserable place. It's not fun. It's torture. I have to say that
it's really literally complete hopelessness.
It's torture, right?
In the midst of all this, and this is really, really important, you know, I talked earlier about how there are times we pray for individuals and they're instantly healed of different things, and even with mental illness. I've seen that myself with my own eyes.
Yes.
Sometimes, though, it doesn't happen that way, and God hasn't abandoned us. It just means we need to keep pressing in. And so I want to take a minute and just, again, turn the page again on this and ask Brian this question, because I already know the answer, so that's why I can ask this question, is that God has still been actively involved in this whole process from beginning to end. Can you talk to us a little bit about that, about how God really showed up and did some amazing things?
Yeah, you know, well, certainly there's times where I'm praying, and it would appear to seem like, you know, God's not there, God's not answering, why is not God responding, what's going on, whatever. But, you know, the thing is, you know, as I spend time with God, suddenly, I become aware of Him speaking, you know, where as you get to know the voice of God, you know that He's like, Brian, go do this, move here, say this, or whatever the case is. And so, during especially this last bout with Brenda, God has given me such a heightened, an acute awareness of Him speaking to me that there's been absolute times, multiple times, where He's given me a word to say, Brian, you need to do this. As an example, there was one time, I'm sitting in my office downstairs in my house, and it was wintertime, and Brenda says she's going to go out for a little walk. I said, okay, no problem. And this is the time where she was dealing with depression. In about a half an hour, I was there at my desk, and all of a sudden, I heard God literally say, Brian, you need to get up this very moment and go look for her. And it's like amazing how God just, He intervenes, He moves when it's needed. And God gave me wisdom of what to do and how to react, and make a long story short, it's a happy ending, but, and there was multiple times like that where God just clearly speaks, and gives the right word and gives us a word of knowledge or understanding. And that's the coolest thing, to know that God is right there every step of the way, And the key, one thing I want to make clear to you is that it's like when when you're going to go into battle, you don't wait to the battle to happen to prepare yourself for the fight. You need to be in training ahead of time, so when the battle's there, you are prepared. And I just can't say enough, I just want to say this little plug, that spending time with God, in His Word, in prayer, connecting with Him, it sharpens your spiritually, so that when it's not if the battle's going to happen, it's when the battle's happened, you were ready to react to it. And it just, that's where Brent and I are. We never let our guard down, even to this day. We're always dressed for battle. Not that we're walking around in fear, but the fact is the enemy is ready to attack at any time. And so you spend your time in prayer, spend your time in the Word.
I just want to say, too, just that time, when I think back to that time in the woods, automatically God shows me the spiritual battle happening in the spiritual realm. Like, I actually see angels fighting off all the wicked, the demons, those who were, the enemy who was trying to, end things for me. And it's encouraging for me to have those God moments that happen during these times. There was another time in one of my depressions where I was getting ready to take on a little bit what to me was a big challenge, taking kids from church to this camp, and I just suddenly went into this funk, or whatever you want to call it. It it can turn into a paralytic kind of a thing where you just don't want to. I remember I was laying in bed and I wrestled with God. I said, you know what, God? I am not getting up. I'm not doing anything until you take this away from me. I can't have this. And I remember saying to Him that I am totally 100% dependent on you. And I cried out to Him. And it was weird. Immediately, I was better. Immediately, whatever it was left. And I felt like He said to me, yes, that's exactly what I wanted to hear you say, for whatever reason. Amen. And then I was fine. I was able to do, and there have been times like that. Another time, my former pastor prayed over me, and I was actually in the hospital at that point, and I actually felt something. Awesome. So, the spiritual part is definitely there.
Yes.
And then I know you wanted to get into this anyway, yeah. But it's a holistic kind of a yes. deal, because there are chemical things that happen in our body, in our yeah. brains, that affect how we feel yeah. as well. And so they're circumstantial, yeah. you know, and those are things that we have to be proactive about. You know, the chemical stuff, there's natural, there's a lot of things you can do to help balance your body chemistry, mm-hmm. which is good for your whole health anyway. It yeah. just makes sense to do that. And for me, it's a necessary thing. And I've done multiple things to do that. And then the other, the circumstantial, I can't possibly avoid, or, you know, I can't prevent things from happening, right. but I can be mindful of how I handle those things mm-hmm. and be proactive in being ready to deal with yep. stuff, you know. And then, of course, there's the thinking part of it, the how is my thought process, you know. And I find that I have to really battle lies a lot. Mm-hmm. I get caught up in lies and irrational thinking and even just an attitude or a perspective that is just wrong. It's right. just and I have a very I have my husband and I have my best friend Haley, my mom, who's by the way, I have to put a plug in for my mom, because she's on her knees every morning for me, praying right. specifically about this.
That's awesome.
That the blood of Jesus yes. would heal me, you know. And I do too. I pray for that every day. But I have these people, especially my friend Haley,
support.
She'll say to me, okay, Brenda, let's look at all these things you're saying, and we're going to wipe out the lies. And she's like, number one, that's a lie. Number two, that's a lie. Yeah. You know, so these are things, this is where I'm being proactive in not getting to that yes. point, if you understand what yeah. I mean. Because I do think that one thing leads to another, mm-hmm. and you can stop it.
Kind of like a snowball effect.
Exactly.
Kind of thing. Yeah.
Yeah, I do. And I believe God gives us that, yes. you know. And I don't believe it's God's will. You know, this is not of God. It's not, I know that, and I'm positive of that. So
now, there's people here, again, percentage-wise, there's quite a number of people here dealing with depression, either at this very moment, or they have, or it might be a mountain that's coming towards them. What would you say to them as a person who has dealt with this? What might you say to encourage them?
Well, first of all, there's hope. There's it's an absolute true hope. It's yes. not just, it's an absolute hope. Your feelings are not real. You know, you're being, don't buy into the deception yeah. of what you're feeling. It's not real. There's and of course, you know, everybody's situation might be unique. Mm-hmm. People can get into depression for different yes. reasons. So sometimes you have to kind of deal with that stuff. Yep. But just the fact that the person is loved, that God's plan for them is great,
yes.
that there's a purpose for them. Don't fall into the trap. Don't believe the lies that are in your head. Right. I know you really think it's true. It's not. It's a lie. And the enemy wants nothing more than for you to feed into this yeah. and to take you down.
Yes.
You know, and we can. There's a way to fight it,
Amen.
Obviously, through God's word
yes.
and telling ourselves what God says yeah. about us and
Amen.
To us, and what we can do because we have Christ, the Holy Spirit
yes.
living within us, you know. But I do think, I think there are things that we can do in the physical and in the natural.
Being proactive in
just
that
like
part.
You would with any other yeah. part of physical.
Any other sick
or any
part
other
of
deal
our body.
You,
yeah.
yeah, anything you do, or relational issue yeah. or whatever issue you may have. But I know that Jesus died on the cross, and he took all of this, you
yes.
know, and we can be delivered from it. And
we're just, in a sense, walking out the solution.
Yes, yes. The truth is, I tend to be very impatient. So it's like, that's actually something I'm working on, just in the natural.
Yeah.
Just being, I work with disabled children now. So believe me, if you want to learn patience, work with disabled. Mm-hmm. But it's a good thing, because when I'm faced with a negative, you know, psychological situation, I also have to be patient. And I
yes.
have to remember to tell myself, this is not mm-hmm. going to stay. This isn't real.
It's
going to go away. And another thing that I really strongly encourage that has helped me tremendously from a spiritual perspective yep. is to thank God.
Mm.
Just start praising him and just, I don't care what comes to your head to thank him for.
Yes.
It can be the silliest little thing. It could be, you know, yeah. your family,
yes.
your home, your provision.
Yes.
Just start thanking him.
Yes.
And it's like, it's amazing what that does. It's an amazing thing.
An attitude of gratitude.
Yes. Yeah. And yes. And he's really like, he's really driven that home with me a lot. Amen. And to be truthful, exercise. I know now that's a physical, natural thing, but I believe that
plays a role.
It really does. Amen. It does things inside of you. Amen. That's helpful.
Now, Brian, for you as a support person, there's lots of people out here that are in your position. They've maybe got a family member dealing with depression or a friend, coworker at work. What would you say to them to maybe encourage them? Because they could be like, I don't get this. I don't know what to do. And maybe because of that, people like that, and I've been that in the past, we tend to push away. Like, I just don't know how to deal with this. So I'm just, now obviously that's not the answer, is it?
Yeah, you know, there's those group of people that were like, you know, I can't deal with this, I'm out of here, yeah. You know. And then there's other people that think they have these ideas of, oh, this is what needs to be done, yeah. Right? Yeah. First thing I got to tell you to do is do your homework. Get to know what real depression really is, yeah. How it affects a person, so you can truly understand the best way to be there for your loved one, your neighbor, whoever it is. When you understand the depth of what's happening, then you know how to combat it. And also the thing is, it's like for me, it could be easy to, you know, when Brenda's dealing with something, just to go into my own little corner and not want to talk to anybody about it, not even want to deal with church, and you could even go into your own little negative about it. That's the last thing you need to do. You know, when you're going through struggles, the best thing you can do is to draw even closer to God. Being here, sitting in the Word of God, surround yourself around people who love you and care for you. You know, those things are key. And as Brenda says, you know, we are big, avid people about spending time with God and in the Word. You know, that's a renewing of the mind. You know, it's I coined a phrase, you get rid of the stinking thinking.
Yeah.
You know, and that's what happens for a lot of us. And you got to be careful with the environment that you place yourself in. You need people. What you don't need is people saying, oh, well, you need to do this and you need to do that. You need to pray more. You're lacking in faith. You know, you need people that are going to support you and surround you. You know, and it's my plug for the guys that a lot of times we're the John Wayne type and we want to handle it alone. That's not the way to do it. You need to find a brother who you can connect with and who's got your back, who's going to carry the load. Because I tell you something, it's a heavy load to deal with, and it's strong. You know, and when you've got people like, you know, Brenda's mom that are going to bat for you, that's huge. That's huge. So those are the things that I would say that you need to, you know, be doing. And, you know,
I just want to add one more thing that I just remembered. So obviously in preparing for this today, I kind of had some struggles, you know, this week. Like, I feel like I was being attacked a little bit. And he's like, I don't want you getting up there and sharing your testimony and showing that there's hope. So, you know, I was kind of dealing with some stuff. And of course, Bucky and Brenda Golden knew that I was preparing to do this. And Bucky told me that last night, poor Brenda didn't get any sleep last night because she was praying for me. And she was interceding on my behalf.
Amen.
And I had the best sleep ever. I am so sorry that Brenda didn't, but I'm so thankful for that. And I just can't. Intercessory prayer is so important.
Yes.
And I'll tell you, if I come to your mind randomly, just pray for me, you know? And I do the same for others that I know, you know, I think that's such an important thing. And it's so powerful.
Yes.
The power of prayer is real, you know, and the effects are miraculous.
Amen.
So,
amen. So,
very
so
thankful
good.
For that.
That one of the ways that God spoke to you through this last period that you were dealing with was through a song. I think it was Danny Gokey. I think it was one of the songs that he did.
Yes.
And what's that song
Tell
about?
Your Heart to Beat Again. So he wrote this song out of hardship that he went through.
Yeah.
It wasn't necessarily depression. I think he had lost a loved one. And I think he's had more hardships, actually, since then. I think other songs he's even written. It's amazing how many beautiful, amazing songs have come out of pretty hard times. So.
Yes.
And when I heard the words, it was very encouraging to me because it's giving you hope. It's telling you that, you know, and also that you don't have to be defined by these things. But you don't have to be defined by your past or by, you know, like I could easily fall into the trap of feeling like a failure, feeling guilty, feeling embarrassed, feeling ashamed.
Yeah.
And God doesn't want that. That's not who God. That's not what God is about, Amen. You know. And I don't have to claim that.
And what's cool about it is now that you've kind of went like this, now the enemy can't use any guilt or shame or any of that anymore because it's all out there, so to speak.
Right.
Amen.
Right.
Amen. I know you guys are going to do that song for us. So as they're setting up, I just want to give you scriptures. Ecclesiastes 4:12, familiar scripture, but let's just have a look at it. It says, though one may be overpowered by another, two can withstand him. And a threefold cord is not quickly broken. You know, I think of Brenda or anyone dealing with depression, if you try to do it on your own, the enemy will roll right over you. You need help. You need someone to come alongside you. You need to call out to God. You need to call out to godly people around you that they will stand with you. Not so much people to tell you, you got to do this or do that, but say, I'm with you. I'm praying for you. What can I do for you? Just to come alongside to support. And that's what that two can withstand, right? Though one may be overpowered by another, two can withstand him. Well, the him is obviously the enemy. And the idea is that as two stand together, there's strength in that. But I love the third part. A threefold cord is not quickly broken. Listen to me. That's Jesus wrapping around the whole thing, holding the whole thing together. Jesus is the ultimate answer. Jesus is our deliverer, all right? So even with what you've heard with, you know, different medical treatments and that, that was God's way of Brenda working through her healing. God's way for you could be instant deliverance through prayer, instant. But here's the thing, and you heard this as Brenda was sharing, it was through prayer, through the revelation of God, through a vision by Robin that actually talked about the type of treatment she was going to get. Amazing. That's God stuff. You know what I'm saying? God was still in the midst of it. Now, it might not be the path that you and I would choose to go, but that's the path that she was on, and God was with her that way. Amen? And here's the thing. If you're suffering with depression here, I don't want any person here to feel guilt or shame or condemnation. I want you to feel loved and cared for and cherished, and that there's hope when you come to this place. I can't speak for the church worldwide. That's above my pay grade. You know what I'm saying? God can deal with the pastors there, but that's our heart here and the leadership here. So if you're dealing with something like this, depression or those kinds of things, anxiety, which is a twin sister to depression, right? You're dealing with that, then please ask for prayer at any time, whether it be today or another day. Don't feel ashamed or guilty. You know, because the enemy will tell you, well, you're a Christian. You shouldn't have these problems. Come on. Just put all that aside. You know, let's take it to Jesus and let him help us, however he wants to do that. Amen? And if you're a friend of someone or a family loved one that's dealing with depression or anxiety, listen, we're happy to pray with you on these issues as well. Again, don't feel any guilt or condemnation. God wants us to be able to come to him with open hearts, with everything and anything that we have a need of, whether it be mental illness or physical ailments or just issues of life. He wants us to be able to come to him. Amen? Amen. So listen, here's what's going to happen. They're going to start to sing this song. Let's stand up together. Take a few minutes in your heart and ask the Lord, what are you saying to me today? Let's let him speak to us. And here's what's going to happen. After the song, I'll just pray to close. But if anyone would like prayer or just want to talk to someone, come up to the altar area and we'll just spend some time with you, all right? So let's just, you know, you can sing if you want. The words are going to go up. But use this time just to say, Lord, what are you saying to me?
Your shadow like you've never been before. The life you knew in a thousand pieces on the floor. And words fall short in times like these. When this world drives you to your knees, you think you're never gonna get back to the you that used to be. Tell your heart to beat again. Close your eyes and breathe it in. Let the shadows fall away. Step into the light of grace. Yesterday's a closing door. You don't live there anymore. Say goodbye to where you've been. And tell your heart to beat again. All right now, love's healing hands have pulled you through. So get back up, take step one, leave the the darkness feel the sun? 'Cause your story's far from over and your journey's just begun. Tell your heart to beat again. Close your eyes and breathe it in. Let the shadows fall away. Step into the light of grace. Yesterday's a closing door. You don't live there anymore. Say goodbye to where you've been and tell your heart to beat again. Let every heartbreak and every scar be a picture that reminds you who has carried you this far. 'Cause love seems farther than you ever could. In this moment, heaven's working everything for your good. So tell your heart to beat again. Close your eyes and breathe it in. Let the shadows fall away. Step into the light of grace. Today's a closing door. You don't live there anymore. Say goodbye to where you've been and tell your heart to beat again. Your heart to beat again. Beat again. Oh, so tell your heart to beat again.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Father, I just thank you for Brian and Brendan sharing their life with us this morning. And Lord, I pray that it encouraged us to look to you, Lord, for our strength, that no matter what valleys are ahead, Lord God, for that matter, what mountaintops are ahead, regardless, Lord God, that you are with us. You're in the depths, the heights, and everywhere in between. So, Lord God, we thank you for this day. We ask you to bless every person here. Lord God, as they go forth from this place, I pray that they go with just a heart of gratitude of your love for us, Lord God, that you are for us and not against us. And though the enemy may try, we have victory in Jesus. So bless each person, Lord God. Strengthen them in their faith walk with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.